Masechet Chorot, page 28, we are 8 lines from the top of the page. In a secular court system, there are certain responsibilities upon a judge. We are human, judge can make a mistake. In some cases, he's obligated to compensate, others not. In Jewish law, obviously, there are some point that we say that it's not part of the judge responsibilities, while other times we do say it is the responsibility of the judge. When and where and how we hold that way? When the judge, when he rules in a certain way and it was a mistake, he needs to hold the responsibility in full, and when we say that he is exempt from compensations. But before that, we are well known in the food business, those who are involved with any form of manufacturing foods, that you have the obligation by the law, both federal and state law, to put an expiration date, meaning there is a certain period of time you can use that food. Just for us to understand the concept, the same applies when it's come to the Kedushat Bechor, the sanctity of the firstborn. When a Kohen receives it, obviously we explained day before yesterday that if the animal carry a blemish, he has the obligation to do the Shechita and consumption in a certain period of time, but not exceeding a time of a year, versus if that firstborn animal that was given to him without blemish, then he have the obligation to bring it as a korban, as an offering, not exceeding a year. So, obviously, there are many questions involved in that, such as how you determine a blemish, how do you determine the exact time, and how you treated those who are not expert and make those decisions, and again, make sometimes the wrong decision over blemish or unblemished animal, since they rule without the expertise. And many more, how you treated Bechor firstborn Bazman Hazeh nowadays. So let's start, as we said, 8 lines from the top of the page. Nolad lo mum betoch shnato. If a blemish developed within its first year, Rashai lekaimo kol shneim asar chodesh. It is permitted for the owner to maintain the animal for the entire 12 months. Now, there are different girsaot between Hagahot v'tzionim and the Bach. We go by the Bach. He said, le'achar shnato arishona, that's the Mishnah on page 26b. They said if a blemish developed after 12 months, אינו רשאי לקיימו אלא עד 30 יום. So it is permitted for the owner to maintain the animal for only 30 days. So as we see that the question is how long the owner allowed to keep it, that's the core discussion. Ibailo, heichei keamar, what exactly the Tana of the Mishnah speaking? When he speaking only with that firstborn that developed a blemish during the year, meaning nolad lo mum betoch shnato rashai lekaimo kol 12 chodesh ulachar shnato namei 30 yom. Does the Mishnah mean that if a blemish developed within the animal first year, the owner is permitted to maintain the animal for the entire 12 months and after the animal's first year also for another 30 days? Or another option, or Dilma, or the Mishnah speaks about two different scenario. Heicha denulad bo mum betoch shnato, rashai lekaimo kol 12 chodesh. Or the Mishnah referring to two different situations, which is in a case where the blemish developed within the animal first year, the owner is permitted to maintain the animal for the entire 12 months, meaning from the time of the beginning of his birth, or according to Shita Mekubetz, it is from the time that the blemish start. However, the two law, and not but nothing more. ואחד הנולד במום לאחר שנתו אינו רשאי לקיימו אלא 30 יום. And in a case where it developed a blemish after 1 year, he is permitted to maintain it for only 30 days. Meaning, Rashi explains, 30 days from the time that the blemish develops, which means לאחר שנתו, meaning after that blemish develop, then you're allowed to maintain for 30 days. Tashma, come and see that the first explanation is the correct one. The Tanya, as we learn in the Braita, Bechor Bazman Hazeh, firstborn in the present time, where there is no Beit HaMikdash, and the animal cannot be brought as an offering. So the whole idea, only after an expert check it, and only after they develop a blemish, then the Kohen can do the Shechita in Achila. So they said, עד שלא נראה להראותו לחכם, until it's developed a blemish that can show to a really erudite, an expert Talmid Chacham, meaning, as long, according to Rashi, that it's not developed a blemish, Tosfot think differently, Rashai lekaimo shtayim v'shalosh shanim, it's permitted for the owner to maintain the animal for 2 or 3 years until it develops a blemish. So even the Torah requires that the Bechor should go not exceeded more than 1 year, as we said earlier, since in our days we are prohibited to do Shechita of firstborn unblemished, so therefore the Kohen can maintain it even after a year until it develops a blemish. And in that sense is a Chidush. The big question is Rashai, even it means Chayav, that's the Kesef Mishneh, add to that. Soon we're going to see it in a translation of the Kesef Mishneh. Anyway, Mishenir'eh la'arotto le'chacham, the moment that the blemish developed, show it to an expert, nolad lo mum. So apparently Yad Binyamin said that we don't need those words. And apparently, according to Yad Binyamin, it's not appearing in the Rashi Girsa. נולד לו מום בתוך שנתו רשאי לקיימו כל 12 חודש. So if a blemish developed within it's the first year, it's permitted for the owner to maintain the entire 12 months. However, אחר שנתו, after a year, אינו רשאי לקיימו אפילו יום אחד ואפילו שעה אחת. He's not allowed to maintain, since the mitzvah is to have the שחיטה within the year. So even 1 day of 1 hour, Rashi said, cannot hold it. אבל מפני השבת אבידה, לבעלים. However, due to the mitzvah of returning lost item to the owner, which means to give the owner time to find a Kohen and give him the animal, our sages said, אמרו רשאי לקיימו, you have an additional extension in that sense of the permission for the owner to maintain another 30 yom, another 30 days maintaining the animal. ועדיין תיבא אלי, and it still let this predicament there, 30 יום לאחר שנתו, או דילמה קודם שנתו. The 30 days period applies to that development of a blemish after its first year, or you meant to say it's before the end of the first year. Meaning, and Rashi here used the word כלומר, אם נולד מום קודם שנתו נמי כאמר, דלאחר שנתו 30 יום. So here, when the Braita used the words and said, after the first year, we can understand ostensibly that that's applied to an animal whose blemish developed only then, or to one that has a blemish earlier and subsequently reached the end of its first year. Tashma, so therefore come and see a braita meforeshet, a very clear braita, that stated, Nolad lomum b'chamisha asar yom betoch shnato. If the animal develop a blemish on the 15th day within its first year, which is 15 days before the end of its year, mashlimim lo 15 yom achar shnato. One completes for it 15 days after its year, which means that it will be totally 30 days from the moment that it develop that blemish. Shmamina, you conclude from here that the owner may maintain the firstborn for additional 30 days if he develop a blemish during first year. So it means the Meforshim said even it happens the last day of the year. So according to this Braita, there's a question. You may argue and say that you don't give it to him. But Rashi said here, תדבב אחר שנתו על מה 30 יום דקטנה מתניתי נולד בומו לאחר שנתו קאי דין נולד בומו בתוך שנתו אפילו אם אחד לקה לממר דנית בלי אחר שנתו 30 יום דלית לאלה להשלמה. So, הביא לאחר שנולד בומו קרוב בסיום שנתו הבין ל 30 יום שנולד בומו. So, it's a big question when exactly you go by that rules. If you zoom in Rashi, obviously it's exceeded the time we can go further with this Rashi, but Marit Al-Ghazi bring also here the view of Tosfot and said that it's since it's all rabbinic enactment and not biblical, so therefore you can go to a chacham, to erudite sage, to understand if it's a mum kavu or not, because if you tell me it's a fek d'oraita, so you have to go stringent. Anyway, mesel el Rabbi Elazar, namar Rabbi Elazar, notnim lo 30 yom mishaa shenolad bo mum. So we follow Rabbi Elazar, that Rabbi Elazar said that one gives the owner 30 days from the time that the animal develop blemish. Ika de amrei, amar Rabbi Elazar, minayin lebechor shenolad b'mum betoch shnato shnotin lo 30 yom achar shnato. So from where do you know that regard to a firstborn animal that develop a blemish during its first year, that one gives the owner 30 days after its year? שנאמר לפני השם אלוקיך תאכלנו שנה בשנה. Because the pasuk said you shall eat it before your Lord your God year by year in the place that your Lord shall choose you and your household. איזו הן ימים החשובים שנה ואומר 30 יום. Which are the days that consider to be a significant part of a year? You may say that there are 30 days which is certain respect are considered a complete year. So you have here a clear indication that such a firstborn may be eaten for up to 30 days before the first 12 months. Meiti ve'nolad lo mum b'chamisha asar yom betoch shnato. If the animal develop a blemish on the 15th day within its first year, which is 15 days before the end of the year, משלימים לו 15 יום אחר שנתו. So they, one completes for it 15 days after its year. So Gemara said, השלמה אין, מהווה לא. So they said, yes, you complete total of 30 days from the time the animal developed blemish, yes, but not to give him an extra 30 days before the conclusion of the year. Tiuvta de Rabbi Elazar, Tiuvta. It's the refutation of the opinion of Rabbi Elazar, is indeed a conclusive refutation. Mishnah Kedosha. Little introduction. So the Kohen received firstborn that carries a blemish. What we said so far, he does the Shechita and he can eat it or he can give it to another one, as Mitzvah Shem we're going to study in Mishnah on page 32. However, part of the condition, he needs to show it to someone who is baki bemumin, someone who is expert, who is specialized in understanding and seeing the issue of blemish animals. Meaning, one who recognizes the difference between permanent blemish, meaning something that never leave the animal's body, stay there forever. Soon you see examples. To something that it's a mover, that it's a temporarily, and it can, you know, those who are familiar with medicine, it can be for short time. And that one, the mumche baki, someone who's very familiar and expert in that, can allow him to go ahead and do the shrita. Later on page 37, we're going to learn that when it's come to mum kavua, permanent blemish, that's the only one who makes the firstborn unfitting for offering. And there is an important, based on the several sources, the Rambam Ilchot Bchorot chapter 3, you see it also in Gemara Sanhedrin 5, you see it the Beit Yosef in Yoredei Ashin Tet and other places, that the expertise, in addition to know the nature of the animal and different type of blemishes, he needs to get a special smicha, a specialty in ordination from the local Bet Din or expert. In those days, they used to have Nasi in Eretz Israel, the head, the president, Bet Din Musmach, well-respected, recognized Bet Din. And that's what Gemara in Sanhedrin, page 5, called it Dayan Mumche, that specialize in that. Now, unfortunately, to this very day, you see people who are try to take over things that they are really not specialized, and it's a sad comment. So here, anyway, the Mishnah dealing with the circumstance of Bechor Baal Mum, the firstborn that carry a blemish, that inappropriately was against, in a way, Jewish law, was did the shechita prior to bdikat mumche, before the expert checked it. Hashochet et habchor umar'e et mumo. So one who slaughtered the firstborn animal, and only then, and only then, and Rashi explained that the expert said that it is a permanent blemish. So he showed it only then to the expert to determine whether it's blemish. And it was, as we said, the slaughter by the expert that it is in fact a blemish, that when there's a slaughter is permitted. Rabbi Yehuda Matir, Rabbi Yehuda allow it for a Kohen to drive benefit from the firstborn. Rab Meir omer oil v'nishchat shelo al pi mumche asur. Rab Meir said, wait a second. Since it was slaughtered not according to the ruling of an expert, it is prohibited. So the Rambam Ilchot Bchorot chapter 3 said that he needs ta'um kvura. You need to bury the same as consecrated item, kodashim shemetu. Later the Gemara expand on Rabbi Meir's point of view. Mi she'eino mumche. So Rabbeinu Ovadia Mevartanura said that someone who, I don't like to use the word charlatans, but someone who's really not expert and not erudite in all understanding and expertise and knowledge and ordination, to re'iyat mumin, to recognize what is permanent, what is not, what is blemish, what is not. Tosfot Yom Tov expand on that. But anyway, mi she'eino mumche, someone who is not expert, ve'ro'e et habchor, so and he examined the firstborn animal, and he rules that this is a permanent blemish. Venishchat al piv, and it was slaughtered on the basis of that quote unquote expert's ruling. Harei ze yikaver, so that animal must be buried. Because someone who's not expert is not heter, is not something you can follow, and therefore has no other choice. And the non-expert, vishalem mi beito. And not expert, we put a fine. He needs to pay compensation to the Kohen for his property, from his own estate. Later Gemara in Amud Bet expand how much. Now the Gemara limited, circumscribes and brings the disputation between Rabbi Meir and Rabbi Yehuda. Amar Rabbi Bar Chana, Bdokin Sheba'ain, Dekule Alma Lo Pligei De'asu. The dispute in the Mishnah between Rabbi Meir and Rabbi Yehuda does not apply in the case of a blemish on the cornea of the eye. That's what we call, some call it cataract. So that's based on what the Torah tells in Vayikra chapter 21. That's permanent. But you treat it as a non-sacred animal, allowed to go and slaughter the firstborn without hakava. Mipnei shem mishtanin. So everyone agrees that it's prohibited. Because such blemish in the eye change after the animal's death, which means that there is no way of determining at the late stage whether it has been a permanent blemish or temporary one. The Rabbi Meir Savar. So example for that is a broken leg, cutting ear, and it's not going to change for the passing tzar amita. Rabbi Meir Savar Gazrin Momim Shebaguf Atu Dokin Shebaayin. So Rabbi Meir hold. So basically they disagree only with regard to blemishes that are on the animal's body. So Rabbi Meir hold that we issue a decree prohibiting the animal in the case of blemishes that are on the animal's body, due to the case of blemishes on the cornea. Rabbi Yehuda Savar lo gazrin al mumim shebaguf atu dokin shebaayin. Now here's Rabbi Yehuda who holds that we do not issue a decree with regard to blemishes that are on the animal's body due to the fact of to the case of blemishes on the cornea. Tanya Namehachi, we learn in the Braita, Ashochet et habechor umaret mumav. So one who slaughters the firstborn animal and afterward shows its blemishes to an expert. Rabbi Yehuda Omer, Bedokin Shebayin Asum Mipnei Shemishtanim, Beumim Shebaguf Mutam Mipnei Shein En Mishtanim. So obviously here, according to Rabbi Yehuda, we differentiate between something that is permanent or not. He says that when it's come to a cornea, blemish on a cornea of the eye, the animal is prohibited because such blemishes change. Versus when it's other part of the body, blemishes on the body, the animal is permitted because these blemishes do not change. Versus Rabbi Meir Omer, Echadze Veechadze, regardless, both the firstborn assume, Mipnei Shehem Mishtanim, because they change. So Rashi here said, Klomar, Rashi have an issue with that concept. So Rashi said, Mipnei Shedokin Shebaayin Shemishtanim Gzera Lemuim Shebaguf Afal Bishen Mishtanim. So they, it's a mefarshim here, that what exactly you call mishtanim, what exactly change and how? Mipnei shen mishtanim sagratach mumim shebagufim mishtanim. So you mean to say that could you say that the blemishes on the body are prohibited because they change? Do blemishes on the body change after the death of the animal? Rather, the blemishes of the body are prohibited due to the decree el mipnei shen mishtanim, based on the case of blemishes on the cornea, which change. Omar Rav Nachman Bar Yitzchak, Rav Nachman Bar Yitzchak says, 28b, Matnitin Nam and Daika, the Mishnah is also precisely formulated, Rab Meir Omer Oil Ben Ishchat, Shelo Al Pi Mumche Asu, Rab Meir said, since this firstborn was slaughtered, not by the ruling of a expert, ordain, so it is prohibited. Shmamina knasa ukakanes Rabbi Meir shmamina. So here you have a clear conclusion that this is Rabbi Meir's fine, and that's the only reason. Meikar adin, it's not the issue. The issue is the knas, the fine. That's the way Rabbi Bar Chana explained the Mishnah. Ibayelu, מפני המשתנים וכולו משתנה, או דילמה איקד משתנה ואיקד לא משתנה. So, because you said that due to those blemishes on the cornea, so it means that all blemishes of the cornea of the eye definitely change after the death of the animal or not? Meaning that those who are and there are those not. Le mind of Kamina, what's the practical differences between this? To contradict witnesses who claim that the animal had the identical blemishes in its eye when it was alive. If you tell me that they all corneas change after the death of the animal, they're all liars. We amar the ikad mishtane because lo mishtane. There are those who change and they are not after death, and there are others who do not change. So the court relies on such witnesses. Samchinan alayu. Mai, what is their resolution? Tashma damar Rabba Bar Chana. Sach li Rabbi Yoshua de Minusha. Bo arichav bedukin shem mishtanin. Come and I will show you those that will change. One can conclude by inference that there are some corneas that change after death and there are others who not change. דקאמר לבוב הרכה, בכלל דהשתנה ויקד לא משתנה. Now the Mishnah teaches us, מי שאינו מומחה וראה את הבכור ונשחט על פיו. You have here a situation that someone who's not expert, he saw the firstborn and according to his ruling, it was slaughter on that basis. So the animal must be buried. הרי זה יקבר וישלם מביתו, he needs to pay from his own pocket, from his own estate. The שיטה המקובצת said that we should take out וישלם מביתו. Anyway, leimat nan stamma ki Rabbi Meir. Why? Because the Rabbi Meir holds that the firstborn animal forbidden in all cases where it was not slaughtered based on the ruling of an expert. So he must say, dilma perhaps bedukim sheba'ayin v'divrei hakol. Says the cornea of the eye, we change after the death of the animal, and everyone agrees with the ruling of the Mishnah in such a case. Tanak shum shalem shalem revia ledaka umechza lagasa. When he pays the kohen for the firstborn that become forbidden, he pays one quarter of the value of a small animal, which is a sheep or goat, or half of the value of a large animal, which is the bull. Maitama, what's the reason for this discrepancy? Says the loss of bull, it's obviously relatively great loss, and sheep or goat, relatively small loss. Yach lefum pseder eshlem. So if that's the case, you should pay according to the loss that occurred. Yeah, I understand the question, but anyway, it's just again the Gemara rejected and said dilma bedukim shebaein. לדברי הכל תנא כשהוא משלם, משלם רביע לדקה ומחצה לגסה, מיתם אמר רב פאפה, זה הפסד מרובה וזה הפסד מועט, יהיה לפום פסדה לשלם, אמר רב הונא בר מנוח משמד רב אחא בר איכא, משום גזירת מגדלי בהמה לדקה נגעו. So there is a special decree against those who raised small livestock in Eretz Israel, which we discussed many times. These animals cause tremendous damage to the land. And subsequently, such animals may be raised only in a very specific locations, which means that the Kohen, who was spared exertion, and therefore the sages require not to pay only one quarter of the value. Mishnah. Dan et adin, zika et hachayav, v'chiyev et hazakai. Unfortunately, it happens. If a judge issued a judgment and made a mistake, so that he exempted the liable party or found an innocent party liable, timet ha-tahor v'tiher et ha-tameh, make something that is pure, impure, and something that is impure, pure. Masha asa asui. The judgment stands. V'yishalem mibeto, but the judge must pay damages from his personal fund. So Tosfot in Bava Kama 100 said that it's all into mind. Tarais depend on what exactly occurred. But anyway, ואם היה מומחה לבדין פטור מלשלם. If it was such an expert for the court, he is exempt from liability. So, the Gemara in Sanhedrin 33, you see also the Rambam. The whole Mahalach, what... Anyway, למת נן סתם הקרב מאיר. לדעין דינה דגמרי. דגרמי. So we learn the unattributed Mishnah according to view of Rabbi Meir, who ruled that there is liability for damage caused by indirect actions. Omar Rabbi Ilra Amar Rav, kigon shenasa venatan bayad. So he was referring to a case where a judgment, the way that the judge did it, he took the item in question from one litigant and gave it to the other litigant with his hand, and therefore he directly caused the damage. So the Gemara asks, "Bishlama chayav chiyev et hazakai kigon shenasa venata bayad ela zikai et hachayav echedam ida amar lepatur ata v'alo nasa venatan bayad." Maravina kigon shealo mashkont lo emenu. Here we talk about situation that the lender had a collateral from the borrower, and the judge took it from him and gave it back to the other party. Timet et ha'hor de'agaba u'sheret tiret et ha'me she'ervan im perotam. Mishnah gdosha u'maseh bepara she'nitla ha'em shela ve'chila rabbi tarfon la'klavim u'va ma'aseh lifnei chachamim ביבנה ויתירוה. Ve'amar todos ha'rofe ein para b'chazira yotza ma'alexandria shel mitzrayim she'en chotchim ha'em shela b'shvil shelosh teled. אמר רבי טרפון, הלכה חמורך טרפון. אמר לו רבי עקיבא, רבי טרפון, אתה מומחה לבדין וכל מומחה לבדין, פטור מלשלם. So the Gemara asked, ותיפוק ליה דתאה בדבר משנה, so as Rashi here expanded that, we don't have time, we bring the Gemara in Chulin 54. דינם אליו מומחה ופטור, דתאה בדבר משנה, דתנן בלו טרפות, נתלה עם כשרה ותאה בדבר משנה חוזר בדיבורו, that's the Gemara in Sanhedrin. 33, וכיוון דהיקיים הפרה ומצו למד הרבה ולמישרי אלי, מישרי השתיקח דמה אשר אמר לו לב כלום הוא, זה וזה שחרר הכלבים הוא דהפסיד נפשי, anyway. וטעה בדבר משנה חוזר, הוא השתוער מאותיים. אז זה סד חד עבור כאמר, חד עד טעה בדבר משנה חוזר, ועוד אינמי בשיקול הדעת טעית. So it, when they have disputation between תנאים and המוראים and the הלכה, it's not refer clearly, the final stage, usually they follow one way and the Dayan rules the other way, that's based on the Gemara in Sanhedrin 6, so you can't abrogate it, so therefore he is responsible for that. The Chtam Sofer brings, you see it in Oel Moshe, that we really, Rabbi Tafon made a mistake in Mishnah Meforeshet, and Chtam Sofer expanded on that, but Rashi here said, ועוד דינמי בשיקול הדעת תאיתה, מומחה לבדין אתה ובכל מומחה לבדין פטור מלשלם. So Rashi said, אפילו אבא קיימה, לומצה למדרלה ולמישרלה, וישתה כחיסורו איסור, ואתה יפסדתו, אפילו אחרי פטור מלשלם, דמומחה אתה, that's the point. שיקול הדעת מפרש, ברכם הדסנדרין, דבב, ואז הלהי ועבד, כי אידך מה שעשה עשוי, וישלם מביתו.